This is Joseph Gascho. He joined the University of Michigan faculty at the School of Music, Theater, and Dance last fall, right?
Yep.
He came in fairly soon after that with a project that needed some final mixing and mastering of a group of his called the 21st Century Consort. Very interesting project recorded in the National Cathedral in Washington. And we found ourselves working with tweezers on this operation. Interestingly, he had already done the editing in Logic. I don't know how to run Logic. I work in Sequoia. So it was almost a little role reversal where I was sitting back listening to what edits he had created in Logic and reacting to those and tweaking as necessary. What happened was Joseph at one point said, "Isn't it amazing the level of detail to which we go to fine-tune these recordings these days? Wonder if anybody else appreciates that, if anybody else is listening to it, if anybody else cares?" And we got off onto a little tangent, which I kind of said, well, what's interesting is when I get young musicians coming into the studio, and they will play 99.9% note perfect and be upset with that 0.1% where they might have hit a wrong note in the middle of a 30-second note run and say, "Oh my gosh, I got to do it all over again." Well, the notion came up that is the tail wagging the dog here. When Joseph made the point that this ability we have in fine-tuning the editing and mixing of these awesome recordings is starting to affect live performance. And I said, "What? How could that be? Live performance is the holy grail, that's it." And he said, "Oh no, this man is an interesting combination of performer, educator, musician," that's performer, same thing, "and music producer, engineering editor." So I will let him describe some of those many hats and how he works with that.
Great.
Joseph Gascho.
Great, thank you. Yay. So my first recommendation about your computers is just buy a Mac. I made this switch to Mac, kind of similar to David, just for software reasons, like 3 years ago. And I know it's not for everybody, but it's been fantastic for me and very easy. And yeah, I don't know, at least at this stage, it's just made my life much easier from many points of view. So my uncle is a huge Microsoft fan, so I realized that, you know, it can be good for everybody. But I think there's so much out there that can fit, you know, everybody's needs, and this works. You know, watch it like freeze up now on me, but it works well. But it's fun to hear you guys talking about these kind of things, and I think that what David points to, and maybe the what I would say, maybe the kernel or the real seed of what I'm saying, and I think I probably come at it from a slightly different point of view than you, because at heart I come from it only from a kind of aesthetic, artistic point of view. And I use this machine and all these fancy machines for an artistic purpose, and it's secondary for me. And I've learned that stuff, it's really great that people care about those things so much, because the little teeny things you guys do, or sometimes I do, they do make a huge difference. It's a little bit that whole, you know, the old kind of fable of, you know, the butterfly in the rainforest makes the hurricane. I'm not saying we're actually making hurricanes, but small things have large impacts. And it's great to have people that are trying to make the kind of nuts and bolts things work as well as possible. And in the big picture, what Dave and I are also talking about is, for me, getting to know some of the nuts and bolts has affected how I play. It's affected how I think about things and even the idea of what a recording is, which I always thought I knew what that was. And now I realize a recording is a totally different thing than what I thought it was. And I guess having been on both sides of it, or there's more than two sides, on several different sides of that process has been really fascinating. To witness people coming in with a really strong vision of what they want, and then how does that, it takes a long time from that, for that vision and a lot of steps and often a lot of people for that to turn into something. We're kind of used to, like, we play, they listen. Or you play, I listen. You know, who knows who the you and the I are in there. But generally in music, there's a performer or group and there's a listener. But adding this intermediary, which is fantastic, it in a certain sense does make music, if not immortal, last for a long time, at least until, you know, I guess we don't have the technology to play things anymore. But that space in between the playing and the listening is really very rich. And I think part of what, again, I'm not a historian of this technology, so I just give you my kind of impressions, and you may know much more than me, but I think there was a time when the philosophy was more, can we create the real sound of the concert hall? Can we recreate the exact sound of the instruments? And I don't think that's quite what we go for anymore. And certainly, if you're going to listen, you know, this is, I'm probably preaching to the choir here. I'm not a bad musician. I've produced a lot of records. I don't have a stereo at home. Isn't that crazy?
No, actually, it's pretty typical. Musicians often have the worst hi-fi systems.
Right, but I don't have anything. If I want to play a CD, I go to my daughter's room, where she's got the little teeny like boombox, and I put the CD in there. You know, so yeah.
Why is that?
Because and I guess it's not totally true. I take it back. I have a studio downstairs where I have some nice monitors and I can listen. But in terms of like playing for pleasure, like I've got a grand piano, I've got three harpsichords, guitars, you know, I'm doing music, you know, I'm doing it like 10 hours a day and I'm thinking of it like the other 14. And, you know, if I turn on the radio, it's NPR and it's no music. You know, I just want to hear somebody talk. So I kind of got lost on that rabbit trail. But I think I can return to the fact of, like, what a recording is. Is it an archive of something that exactly happened? Do we try to capture it? Or do we try to make the recording itself almost a new genre of a performance? And that's certainly what I've realized is more important for myself as a producer and somebody doing editing and mastering. We want something that sounds really good. Hopefully, maybe in a certain way, maybe it can sound better than the performance. How many people in a hall get to sit at the best spot? Not too many. Maybe a handful. And I know this for sure. For many, many concerts, there's sweet spots. You will notice, like in certain halls, you get the standing ovation from this one area. That's the sweet spot. You know, chances are those people, for some reason, are going to really dig it. And then somebody, you know, 20 feet away, I played the same way, but they didn't hear it that way. Just whatever reflections and things happened in that hall. So, you know, when you spend 12 hours and thousands of dollars to decide, oh, the mic's going to go here, not here. You know, at what point is that worth it? And those are the kinds of decisions we're making. And then post-production, thinking once you've been through the editing cycle and mastering and deciding these sound things, you approach the very beginning of the process differently too. Thinking that I want to capture something, maybe it's not perfect, but I realize it's something I can deal with later. You know, I'll maybe make my recording drier because I have more chances to do stuff. It's hard to subtract sound, it's easier to add sound. So we maybe like take an extra risk to be a little too dry and then we add something. So all these kinds of decisions make a lot of difference in what we do. And when if somebody hires me to produce a record for them, you know, you don't just say yes. You have to have this discussion of, like, what kind of record do you want? What's important to you? You know, for who I am I going to be able to help you? Am I going to get to do something with this? And I think that's one of the things I've enjoyed so much about having some technical skill with editing. And this is the biggest thing I've realized is that there's artistry in every step of the process. And I would say, you know, you could define that in a lot of ways, but I would say that at least it's decisions that transcend technical decisions. At every step, it's a matter of taste. And, you know, when you come to a point, it's not a yes or a no. It's here's 20 options. I can quickly rule out, you know, 15. And I can spend another 20 minutes on, like, getting it down to 2. And then we can debate for 3 hours which one's better. But what I have loved about that, and what I think people I work for like, is that there's a kind of continuity of vision through that. For example, this recording with the 21st Century Consort. So this was a group of players from the National Symphony that recorded some contemporary music in the National Cathedral. So those are high-powered people. And you know, the conductor is the dean of the school here. You know, it's the concertmaster. It's very intimidating, strong people. So how can I possibly produce them? I'm just trying to give them feedback so that they can do the best job and they realize what comes through and how I can help them. And then what I heard, you know, just in passing, it was like 5 years earlier, but it was one of those things where the bell didn't ring right away, but, you know, a year later it did. Just making a concert with some people, they said, yeah, we recorded this a couple of years ago and, you know, it was great, blah, blah, blah. And then we got the CD and it was like a totally different group. Whoever edited it, you know, just had a totally different idea of what was good. It didn't feel like us. And so I think that's one of the strengths that have been for me. Like, I'm not the fastest editor. It's like 1% of my career to edit things. So I'm not as fast as David, but I have the value that, like, I was there with them. I was telling them I like this, I didn't like that. We kind of got on the same page. And then when I'm the guy in the studio hearing them again, I know, oh, Claire thought this. You know, I might like this the best, but I know she liked this the best. Because we had this discussion, you know, and I was there. And they knew I felt like this was important. So the kind of continuity has been very nice and very fun. And I think, you know, every time you edit something with people you worked with, you have this kind of relationship of wanting them to do really well. I think that's what it is from the beginning. How can I help these people make this recording happen really well? Yeah.
If you had 2 takes, one where the musician played it note perfect, they say, finally, I got all this and that I wanted to get in right. The line.
Right.
And another take where you felt, I don't want to stack the deck, but where you felt some emotion out of it, but it wasn't perfect. Something might have been just a touch flat, something might have been a touch early,
right.
Whatever. Which would you choose?
Right. So it's, you know, it's not a yes or no question.
Wouldn't you choose the emotional one and edit out the bad notes?
Potentially.
Not always possible.
No, yeah. But when it's possible.
If it's possible, right. You know, and okay, quickly you get to that, it's your budget. You know, we can all spend 20 more hours re-editing it. I can spend another 20 hours, and every time I'm going to get, you know, X over whatever closer, right? So it gets practical too. And unless you're just Orpheus of an editor, you can't always fix stuff perfectly, you know? Yeah, question back there?
There's one third option that I would believe in, and that is to pick what the musicians felt represented what they wanted to project to the audience.
But But this is why I'm asking how the producer would deal with this.
Right, but it's a loaded question.
Yeah.
Right, yeah.
If you have the musician telling you, I want take seven, and the producer may say, but wait a minute, I thought it felt wonderfully in take three, can't, you know, how hard do you talk them in or out, or don't you?
No, I mean, well, that's again why you had that discussion at the very beginning. Like, feel like, what kind of person is this? How important is it? And honestly, you know, we talk about maybe like wrong notes, but if it's anything other than a keyboard, then it's just variations of wrong notes. How out of tune can it be? I mean, if it's this much out of tune, nobody's bothered. If it's this much out of tune, a couple people.
The musicians will be bothered.
Right, you know? And at what point does it matter? So it's always a scale. And I guess I just try to keep that in mind. And I tend, you know, my personal preference is I don't care so much about accuracy. And that's not, you know, that's not easy these days because you make something and then it's out there for good. So, but I still always will go for the flow and the direction of the music. Sometimes you can't do it. And, you know, and on it, and I get into serious discussions with people about this. And it's amazing how two different people can hear things very differently. I mean, David knows this way better than me. But you don't want to have a lot of people in there telling you how to edit or, you know, because, you know, two really highly esteemed people can feel it completely differently. That this is so out of tune. What are you talking about? It's perfect. What's wrong with that? You know? And they're like, this is rushing. I love the direction of this. You know, it's very kind of high-level political discussions because it's you have to think very clear. Let me talk, and then I'll come back there. Go ahead.
Do you rehearse differently for a recording than you do for a live performance?
Yes, definitely.
How?
It depends. For me specifically, I play a lot of Baroque music. The group that I have, I'll play a track for you later, but we do a ton of improvising. That's super dangerous in recordings because, you know, it makes the editing really frightening because maybe the big picture of the piece is the same, but on one take, I was playing up here with like 16th notes. And the second time, I was chilling down here with half notes. I can't edit that anymore because it's going digga-digga, but it's not going to work. So the first recording we made, we were very naive. And we just improvised like crazy. And then the editing got hard. And fortunately, you know, we had to make some compromises. There were some things we would have loved to make edits. We just couldn't do it because, you know, somebody was on a different instrument even, you know, or things like that. I mean, hopefully that's something your producer takes care of. But that's almost too specific. But we've a little bit reined in our improv in recordings compared to performances where you can do whatever you want. But realizing in recording you may want to make some edits. You know, again, we don't like shut it down and say you got to write everything out. But we kind of say try to stay in the same world so we're not going to go crazy later. So, yeah.
Maybe it's a silly question because I only work on restoring antique commercial recording.
Yeah.
But you had two takes for in the studio. And musicians didn't change. You didn't have a guy on a bassoon doing one, now the next time he's on a recorder or something.
Yeah, yeah.
So they're in the same seating positions, they're playing maybe a 5-minute short piece.
Yeah.
And somebody goofed somehow, fluffed a note, and they just scream and holler, throw it in the ash can, it's garbage, it's junk.
Yeah.
Couldn't you take that note out of the other take and just carefully insert it?
Oh, yeah.
That's easy to do. You know, and if you did it without saying anything, and then you get back together the next day and say, what do you think of this?
Right.
He says, where's my fluff note?
Right.
Wow, I love it. You know,
right.
That kind of thing.
Yeah, I mean, I think those kind of things, I mean, very old recordings like that, I mean, David, you have to help me here, or maybe somebody, but like, those, it wasn't possible to edit at the very beginning
of
recording.
So the performance bar would have been totally different because it was probably direct to disc, direct to something, and there is no editing in that mode. So somebody has a derailment, it becomes a train wreck pretty quickly, and as you say, they abandon it totally.
Yeah.
Do you find that people listen to recorded music differently? Like I recall when I first started listening to music in my teens.
Yeah.
I would have a few records and I would listen to them over and over again.
Yeah.
Now I have thousands of recordings.
Some of which you've never listened to, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Exactly.
Or I'll listen, I'll have a few that I listen to many times. But most of my many, many recordings I will listen to 1, 2, 10 times, and then they go up on the shelf, and I'll listen to them again 5 years later, maybe.
Right.
Or maybe never again.
Right, yeah.
And
no,
so I have a different relationship with the music that I do have.
Right.
Along the same lines, when I started listening to LPs in the 1950s, I can recall a Brahms symphony where the horn player screwed up. I didn't know it at the time. And when later in life I heard the symphony performed properly, I thought it was wrong.
I had a tick on Beethoven's third, the Eroica, in the first movement.
Yeah.
And every time I hear that on my first recording, and every time I hear that symphony, when I get to that point in the music, I hear that tick.
Yeah. Even though it's not there.
Yes.
Yeah. Right.
Or I anticipate it.
Right. But you can also hear things like, if you fall in love with a certain recording, you can never not hear that soprano singing it, And there are things like that. I think in general, it's not an active thing, but I am searching for how can we bring value back to these? Because they're too easily accessible now. I don't know.
It's a different world. The world is now awash in digital images and in sound images.
Yeah.
And then you have the combination of the two in movies.
Yeah.
And we are literally inundated by them. It's a different relationship.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, I just got an old book of Ansel Adams photographs. Well, okay, it was special when he did them 80 years ago.
Right.
Now, I mean, they're still special because they're historic.
But I think, I would say even they're still, and you said you bought a book.
Well, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right, there is this thing of with those really fine things, you have to get real close to the original source for it to be really special, right? And
I didn't buy his prints when they were $200
right.
each, because I was too poor.
Yeah, exactly. But that's how you would really start to get it, right? And if I want anybody to really, music's a little different because it's experienced in time, but how can we bring a value back to a recording? How can we make it something special? It's hard these days. We haven't quite figured it out yet because it is just too much stuff.
To try and bring it back to the point of this, we have talked about these note-perfect, edited, call them sanitized recordings affecting young musicians and how they play.
Yeah.
Talk about that if you actually feel it's affecting how they're playing these days. And if that's a good or a bad thing, I don't know.
Right. It's hard to say. I mean, I think the feeling of, I would say being someone kind of in the middle of the generational span, at Michigan, for example, and I think maybe this is a general thing. Maybe it's bemoaned a little bit the lack of musicality of the young, of the students. And that the playing's really accurate, but it's not...
No soul.
Yeah, or that's not the priority, and I think plenty of it has to do with recording, or think about a review of a concert. I mean, that's what the reviewers say now. They can't help but I can prove I heard it. The clarinet played a wrong note here. The pianist, these little things that I think you would never read in reviews from 100 years ago. This kind of ridiculous nitpicky stuff. Where's the question of the music in the context? Where's the shaping of phrases? We have become very fastidious and we care about these things. I guess I do kind of lament it. And I do, I think of, there's a pianist that I like, Grigory Sokolov, a Russian pianist, and he won't record. He will only make live recordings. And he's very fortunate because he's ridiculously good and never screws up. But that's not even true. I've heard some things that he does. But he really feels a recording should be unedited. And in a perfect world, I agree with him. And I'm not yet comfortable doing this. I think it's a goal for me in the next 10 years to make an unedited recording.
Ooh,
you know?
That's gutsy.
Yeah, I mean, it's just...
That's gutsy.
Right. You got to, like, shoot for the clouds, though, you know?
You wonder, then, if that could become a marketable notion. If people are so tired of, in fact, the sanitized, perfect, metric recordings, ho-hum, you pull them out every 5 years, as you've said, or maybe you don't even go back to listen to them at all, because some of us are a little tired of hearing how great Rubinstein was and how great these old recordings were with their flaws.
But this concept seems to me deals with classical music. If you look at jazz, for instance, the concept of precision isn't there at all. It's all spirit. It's all mood. It's all feeling.
I don't agree.
Oh, I think so. I think so.
I think it's like classical music was 70 years ago too. And I think jazz has the wonderful like ability to have that, has that feel. We believe that, but it's not really that way. I mean, of the jazzers I know, it's the same continuum as in the classical world. Some people are, as like I was saying with this improv kind of thing, some jazzers are really improvising. And they're going all out. There's plenty that aren't.
Okay, well, I'm thinking of the jazzers from the 30s, 40s, and 50s.
Yeah, and that, do they have jazz programs in conservatories then?
So how do you
probably
feel?
Not.
No. They do now, so yeah.
So basically they're turning jazz musicians into classical musicians. That's probably a mistake.
I'm not going to say it's a mistake or not. It's what's happening for sure.
Interesting.
Every conservatory has one. And, you know, I haven't done it, so I can't say.
So the only spontaneous musicians are the rock musicians now.
Not even them. Yeah, no.
That's all mini-quantized don't get us started.
Retouching Beethoven scores.
I don't have any problem with it. I mean, I think...
go ahead, I'm sorry.
You know...
I mean, he's editing, right?
Sure. You know, but, I mean, that stuff happens forever, and we always do it. I mean... I don't necessarily want to listen to it, you know. It's fine if he wants to do it. I mean, I do early music, so I have kind of a default thing of like, in general, I want to go to the root source and I want to work with that. I don't want to work with intermediate kind of things.
The reason Mahler said he did it was because the concert halls were larger, and he was trying to duplicate the experience of the original in a larger space.
Exactly. Yeah, and that's fine, you know, and that same logic changed millions of things. I mean, it's why we have this thing, you know.
Sure.
A lot of more people can buy tickets if a loud thing plays, and that's why, you know, singers sing loud, and that's why we now have amplifiers and stacks of, you know, so there's no easy answer.
I mean, so why not accept the fact that as soon as you have, how can I say, recorded something...
Yeah.
It is now a different thing from the musicians that were playing it. It has now assumed a life of its own.
That's what he said at the very beginning.
Right, that's what I said at the very beginning. Yeah, yeah, exactly.
I mean, what I'm saying is, why not just accept that? Because that's what it is. That's
We do. We do accept it. We just don't often realize it.
Okay.
Yeah, and I think there is also the case to be made sometimes, many times, I mean, for the true reproduction recording. Like, let's say I got to play on an unbelievable harpsichord at some chateau in Paris. I think I would really, in that case, I'd shift my priorities to be like, I'm going to make this sound exactly like it does. I'm going to do everything I can. You know, you can understand that circumstance. But chances are, tens of thousands of dollars were paid to set up that circumstance, to fly me there, to like, you know, get David $20,000 to go. That, you know what I mean? It gets expensive to be pure, so it rarely becomes that way. Yeah.
I found as I've gotten older and I've begun to really get into jazz music more than I would have being a child of the 50s and early 60s top 40. I mean, getting Brubeck Take 5, which is really kind of exotic compared to Yeah Yeah Baby Baby Thump Thump.
Yeah.
But as the nice thing about when the CD finally took hold, maybe 10, 15 years ago, the record labels were popping out the alternate takes, and they
right.
were going all the way back
exactly.
to the 70s
yeah.
era.
Yeah.
And if you like the song, you like them both.
It's true.
Being jazz, they are different.
Right.
Because
yeah.
there's a lot of touch and feel, I'm sure eye contact, and maybe right. a little joke,
yeah.
a little OU horse's ass.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
And, you know, that kind of thing. Makes it fun to hear them both.
Yeah. No, it's true. Like, for this, the recording I made about a year ago that has a good amount of improv, I mean, you know, in the end, like, we just got tired of editing and dealing with stuff. We just ran out of steam. But our initial plan was we were going to, like, release all the alternate takes of that stuff. And we still could. You know, it just could happen 5 years down the road when we have time for it. But there's, you know, there's enough stuff in there in the can to, like, have an alternate take for everything. And even beyond that, you could just have an alternate edit. You know, what we thought about for fun sometimes, and I don't know, we might just do it. What if we just make spend, you know, 3 or 4 days in a studio, just throw down a bunch of stuff, just throw it out there on the cloud and be like, you know, $10,000 to the guy who makes the best edit of this piece.
Well, cool. I'm thinking about, as an audience member, I'm watching a group that does improvisations, and I hear this group twice in a row do the same piece,
right.
and it'll be different.
Yeah.
Why not have a CD that has several different improvs of the same piece on it?
Right, that's what we're saying, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah exactly. Yeah, I mean, I think I'm interested in kind of creating a dynamic music player. You know, something where just because you hit play doesn't mean you're going to get the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it'd be fun to have an app or something that's
like a DVD with alternate camera angles.
Right, it could be, but
yeah.
I'm just saying, like, no, the music could change.
Well,
right.
Currently, of course, CD players have a random button. You could play
right.
the tracks randomly,
right.
so you could get...
Right, but what this means is, like, you're going to hit play, and it's going to randomly decide it's going to go through this route of the piece.
Yeah.
And so the performance actually is different every time, even on your CD.
Right.
Yeah.
Your CDs that like Amazing Grace, you know, 13 versions of it all in one CD.
Right, but you're going to get 13 different versions.
Or, yeah.
You're not going to get an infinite number of versions.
Yeah. Well, or you have.
And you're not going to have any choice.
Four seasons. You haven't played
right.
by various peoples, conducted
right.
by various
yeah.
peoples. They all sound. I mean, I kind of like Nadia Salerno's
Sonnenberg, yeah. Uh-huh.
I think she throws a little life into
yeah.
a recording that little bit, you know, bends a note,
yeah.
stretches a note. I can detect that. It's
yeah.
a nice little twist on things.
Yeah.
That's something a little different
yeah.
version of a
right.
maybe a tired old piece.
Yeah, I don't think it's a tired piece at all.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
gotten down to the point, just give them the 24 tracks you originally recorded, let them mix it themselves in a stereo.
Right. They can just do what they want.
I mean,
with
laptops
them.
Are capable of that nowadays.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, there's no way I should be able to edit.
Just be able to go back and get all those 24 track masters.
I mean, this is how I learned to edit. I was putting the takes together for some group, and I was like, you know what? This is kind of annoying. Let me just see if I can, like, glue these together so they can just hear them. So I sent him to the conductor, and he's like, why don't we just hire you to do this? And, I mean, that's how easy it is, you know, that, like, I mean, I had a 10-minute lesson on how to edit. That was it. And it doesn't hurt that I'm a musician.
That's what I was going to say, Joseph. You bring the ears of a juried musician to that process.
Right.
And that is critical. People will look at the display more than once and say, oh, all you do is line up those big bars, right?
Right.
No.
Right. Yeah.
You exactly. still got to have the ears to hear
yeah.
when it's right and wrong.
Right.
And that comes from attending live performance to know what, in fact, triggers the ear brain to say, wait a minute, that doesn't sound like what I hear in a live environment.
Yeah.
And, oh, I heard nothing wrong.
Right.
Through an edit.
Well, and I would say that, kind of to recap, to come back to what we said at the very beginning, like, I think, you know, when I bought this machine, having just done the work on editing with it, like, this machine is, like, it's an instrument. It's a thing for, like, making art. And all it does is zeros and ones. But it's unbelievable the kind of product that you can do. And I really feel like it's just the most amazing tool for doing things. It's, and we've just started to figure it out. But I think all the like technical things that we do, I always want to feel like it has some kind of transcendent purpose. And I think that's why I've kind of loved this process of, in a certain sense, very technical things that I understand this much of, but enough that I can apply it to something that a lot of people tried to do and hopefully, you know, have that come through in a semi-final product. It could be remastered or remixed later, but at this point right now, this is our recording, so, yeah.
Your idea, you know, about the technology influencing the way that the musicians play live?
Yeah.
Do you think reducing music to a score and then having a musician play that score without... Well, let me... years ago, I think Carl Bohm made a recording of a Bruckner symphony.
Okay.
And in the thing, he goes, oh, yeah, that's a chorale from, you know, it's the Pilgrim's Chorale from whatever German place
okay.
it was. Everybody knows how it goes.
Yeah.
Well, there have been a lot of musicians since then that have played that symphony that didn't know that was a little chorale and everybody knows how it goes.
Right.
So they played it exactly the way the notes were written.
Right.
Without the little nuances that Bruckner was thinking of.
Right. Yeah.
When he composed it.
Yeah.
Which, you know, most people would never pick up on that unless you were somebody that knew the original chorale.
Right.
But the musician would be thinking, well, you know, I have played what Bruckner wrote.
Yeah.
Well, has he played what Bruckner wrote?
Right.
And
yeah. No, it's a great question. And you know, it's very clear to me, being somebody who specializes in early music, that there's been a huge change of, like, if you look at a score from 1650, you won't see a single dynamic. You won't see a single bowing. You won't see anything that says, like, with expression or feeling or, you know, it's just the notes. And it's so obvious the music is totally something beyond it. And then the history of notation, it's just got easier and easier to notate things. And composers got more and more picky and wanted more and more stuff. And you can look at a score from 1960 and almost every note has a dynamic or an articulation. So I think it's kind of like that, what is it, Kurt Gödel's theorem about, like, mathematics. Like, it can never prove itself. And I think a musical notation system, it can never notate everything. So I would say the music always has to be unnotatable.
Okay.
And part of the joy is, like, figuring out all those other things that you can't notate. So.
Okay, yeah. So you've read...
I read Gödel, Escher, Bach, so I know the
all
cliff
right.
notes.
Okay,
so, yeah.
Good.
I think we need to wrap up, but it's been a great pleasure talking
yeah,
to you guys.
Yeah, let's do wrap up on
great.
That.
Great, thank you. Thank you. Thanks, David.
Sure.
Great.
Thanks for coming.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.